everybody. My name is Enikő Mészáros. I am the president of the Hungarian Jane Goodall Institute. And we are very, very proud and very happy that we can have Dr. Goodall again in Hungary. So Dr. Goodall has so much titles that I could name them one by one, but we know her as she is the messenger of hope and the peace. So please welcome.
It's been an amazing journey, this life of mine. This planet has filled me with the wonder of all living things, great and small. We cannot ignore this earth that surrounds us, that feeds us, shelters us, replenishes our bodies and our souls, and stretches our imaginations, where animals, plants, air, water, all care for us. We're all interconnected, people, animals, our environment. When nature suffers, we suffer. And when nature flourishes, we all flourish. I do believe in the possibility of a world where we can live in harmony with nature, but only if every one of us does our part to make that world a reality. So that when you look back over your journey, your life, you can truly say, I did make a difference.
Well, good evening to everyone. We started off this evening with the beginning of life on Earth, and what an amazing film that was. And now we move to a different kind of experience. But before I start talking about the chimpanzees, let me bring a different voice into this space. I'd love to be able to talk to you in Hungarian, but I'm afraid that's impossible. But I can greet you with the sound you would hear if you came with me to Gombe National Park in Tanzania. This is me, this is Jane, in chimpanzee language. And that actually is a very important call, because chimpanzees can travel around by themselves or in small groups. These little groups are continually changing. Sometimes many of them join together to form a large gathering when there's a delicious fruit that's become ripe in one particular place. But because they're always changing groups, sometimes a mother will lose her adult offspring, or a brother will lose a sister, or a male will lose track of his buddy. So you stand up on a ridge and you make that call, and every chimpanzee has his or her own individual call. It's called a pantoot. And they'll make that call and then they listen. And if the other individual is within earshot, they usually reply, and so the two can become reunited. So it's an extremely useful call, and there are many variations on it, but that's the basic usefulness of it. But I want to go back before that to my childhood. Maybe we'll talk about my birth later, but right now, what I want to say is that I was born loving animals. And I was fortunate in having a very understanding and supportive mother. And so when I was 1.5 years old, she came into my bedroom, and I'd taken a whole handful of earthworms to bed with me, and of course a lot of earth too. But instead of scolding me, she just said quietly, Jane, they need to be out in the garden or they'll die, and we carried them back outside. But the story I want to share, which I know some of you know, but I tell it for a reason. We lived in London, but when I was 4.5 years old, we went, my mother and I and my baby sister, we went for a holiday to a farm in the country. And in those days in England, farms were farms. Cows went around in the fields along with the pigs, and the chickens pecked around in the farmyard. There were no intensive factory farms for animals in those days. And I was given a job to help collect the hen's eggs. So there were little wooden hen houses with nest boxes around the edge where the hens were supposed to lay their eggs. And I would go around, and if there was an egg in the box, I would put it in my basket. So apparently, I started asking everybody the same question. Here's the egg, sort of so big. Where did it come out? How did the hen lay the egg? And nobody told me to my satisfaction. So what I do remember is seeing a hen go up into one of the hen houses, and she was brown, and I thought to myself, ah, she's going to lay an egg. So I crawled after her, which was a big mistake. And with squawks of, I suppose, fear, she flew out. And I remember thinking, remember, I'm only 4 and a half, but this is a very, very strong, vivid memory. No hen will lay an egg here. This is a frightening place. And so I went into an empty hen house and I hid in a corner at the back and waited. And waited. And waited. Which was fine for me, but my poor family had no idea where I was. And they'd even called the police. Apparently I was gone more than 4 hours. And finally my mother sees this excited little girl rushing towards the house, all covered in straw. And how easily she could have said, how dare you go off without telling us, don't you dare do it again, which would have killed all the excitement. But instead, she sat down to hear the wonderful story of how a hen lays an egg. And the reason that I tell that story is, isn't that the making of a little scientist? The curiosity, asking questions, not getting the right answer, deciding to find out for yourself, making a mistake, not giving up and learning patience. It was all there, and a different kind of mother might have crushed that early scientific curiosity, and I might not be standing here now. As I was growing up, still a small child, she thought, well, if I find books about animals, Jane will learn to read more quickly, and that was true. Dr. Doolittle was on my list, but then when I was 10 years old, this was an England in wartime. World War II was raging. My family had very little money. My father was off fighting in the war. And I loved books. There was no television back then. Some young people find that hard to imagine. No television. So we learn from books, from talking to older people, and from experience, like being outside in nature. And so I spent hours and hours in libraries and secondhand bookshops. And I used to save up my tiny bits of pocket money for books in these secondhand bookshops. And when I was 10 years old, I found this little book, which I still have. It was called Tarzan of the Apes. I just had enough money for it. I took it home. I took it up my favorite tree, where I used to spend hours to be near the birds. And I read it from cover to cover. And of course, I fell passionately in love with this glorious lord of the jungle. And what did he do? What did Tarzan do? He married the wrong Jane. I was very, very jealous. But in fact, that was when my dream began. I would grow up, go to Africa, live with wild animals, and write books about them. Everybody laughed at me. How would I do that? Africa, we didn't know much about it. Was still the dark continent. There were a few colonialists and missionaries out there. We had very little money. It was expensive to go to Africa. There were no planes going back and forth. And worst of all, I was just a girl. And girls didn't have those opportunities back then. And so people laughed at me, Jane, why don't you dream about something you can achieve and forget this nonsense about Africa? But not my mother. And she would say, perhaps not in exactly these words, but her message was, Jane, if you really want this, You're going to have to work very hard, take advantage of opportunities, and never give up. That was her message to me. That's the message I can take to young people all around the world, whatever situation they're in. Well, to cut the long story short, I didn't go to university because we couldn't afford it, and I couldn't get a scholarship because I couldn't learn a foreign language. And so I got a job in London, actually with documentary films, and then came the opportunity, a letter from a school friend whose parents had moved to Kenya. Yes, quit the job, couldn't save up in London, went home, worked as a waitress, jolly hard work for 4 or 5 months, and finally set sail by boat to Kenya. Stayed with my friend. Somebody said, Jane, if you're interested in animals, you should meet Lewis Leakey. And so I went to the Natural History Museum where he was curator, and he asked me all kinds of questions about animals. And because I'd gone on reading books about Africa, because I'd spent hours in the Natural History Museum in London, following my mother's advice, I could answer many of his questions. And I left with a job, basically his secretary assistant. And that led to his offering me this amazing opportunity of going to live with and learn about not just any animal, but the one most like us, the chimpanzee. It was a year before I could start this, because first money had to be found, not so easy for a young woman with no degree, straight out from England. So I went back to England and waited and went on learning what I could, but nothing was known about wild chimpanzees in those days. And the British authorities in what was then Tanganyika didn't want to take responsibility for a young girl on her own in a potentially dangerous situation. But eventually, Lewis got money for 6 months, half a year, from a wealthy American businessman. And the authority said, oh, all right, Jane can come, but she's got to have a companion. And it was that same remarkable mother who came. And she spent 4 of those 6 months. And one of the main things that she did was to boost my morale, because in the early days, the chimpanzees took one look at this peculiar white ape and ran away. And I was so afraid that I would not be able to find out anything significant before the money ran out. So it was really good that I would get back in the evening, and there was my mother to say, but Jane, you're finding out more than you realize. You found this peak, and with your binoculars, you're noticing how the chimps move around in these small groups and sometimes gather together. You're learning how they bend branches over up in the trees to make a sleeping platform or nest. You're learning something about the calls that they make and what they mean. And you're learning about the kinds of foods that they eat. You're learning more than you think. So it was really sad that she left just before that most exciting observation, which I can remember now as though it was yesterday. And I was walking along a trail in the forest, and I saw a chimpanzee crouched over a termite mound. And I saw a black hand reach out and break off a grass stem, push it down into the termite mound, into a termite passage, pull it carefully out, pick off the termites that were hanging on with their jaws. I saw him also break off a leafy twig. And before he could use that as a tool to fish for termites, he had to strip the leaves, which is modifying a natural object, which is primitive tool making. Now, if we saw that today, it wouldn't be particularly exciting. But back then it was. Why? Because back then it was thought that humans and only humans used and made tools. We were actually defined as man, the tool maker. So that when I sent this information to Lewis Leakey by telegram, he sent a telegram back and said, well, now we shall have to redefine man, redefine tool, or accept chimpanzees as humans. It was that observation, and of course I saw it again and again over the next few days and weeks as the termite season, the fertile termites fly out, and this is when the chimpanzees fish for termites. And so it was this that brought in the National Geographic Society, and they sent money for me to carry on with the research. They also sent a filmmaker and photographer, Hugo van Lawick, to record the behavior that I was beginning to record more and more of. It took time, but gradually I got to know the different chimpanzees as individuals. And they all look different, just as we do, but you have to get to know the chimpanzee face to notice all the differences. And the first chimpanzee to lose his fear of me was one that I named David Greybeard, with a beautiful white beard. And it was he who demonstrated tool using. It was he who'd first demonstrated that chimpanzees occasionally hunt and eat small animals. It was David Greybeard who really helped me to gain the confidence of the other chimpanzees. Because when I would arrive in a group that was ready to run off as usual, if David was there, he just sat calmly, and the others sometimes would look from him to me and back again. And I suppose they thought, well, she can't be so dangerous after all. And so in a way, he introduced me to his companions, and I got to know Goliath, his closest companion, who at that time was the number one top-ranking male of the community. And I got to know the old female Flo, the superb mother. And I got to know Passion, who was not a good mother. And I got to know their offspring. And I came to realize that they are tremendously different personalities. There are those who are aggressive and cheeky and pushy. There are those who are shy and timid, good mothers and bad mothers, just in our, as in our society. And the good mothers are the supportive mothers. And if I now look back over the 55 years that we've been doing this study, I think the most dramatic thing is how like us they are. And it was very obvious in their communication, postures and gestures, how like ours they were, kissing, hugging, patting one another, reaching out and begging for food or begging for reassurance, shaking the fist, and so many other ways that we communicate non-verbally. Big difference, of course, we speak a spoken language, which they don't. But the different calls all mean different things. It's quite a sophisticated communication that they have. In fact, it's a sophisticated society where the males are dominant. The group is, at Gombe, it's been around 30 individuals forming a community with 8 to 10 adult males and rather more females. A chimpanzee can live to be more than 60 years old. The first baby is born when the mother is 12, 13, something like that. And thereafter, they have one child only about every 5 years, unless a baby dies, and then they have another child more quickly. And they do not overpopulate their environment the way we do. There's a fairly high infant mortality. And they seem to live in harmony with their environment. The tool using, I learned more about that. There were 9 different ways that the chimpanzees of Gombe used different objects for different purposes. A very dramatic one, there are these very vicious biting ants, driver ants or army ants, and they live in these big nests in the ground, and the chimpanzee will dig in with his hand, then very often try and climb a little way up a tree because the ants swarm out of the nest. And the chimpanzee has carefully prepared a long stick from which all the bark and projections have been moved so it's nice and smooth. Push it down into the nest, leave it for a moment. The ants cling onto the stick in a swarming mound, and the chimpanzee pulls up the stick, sweeps it through his hand, and eats the ants as quickly as possible before they start biting. Usually 5 minutes maximum before they run away because too many ants are biting them. So it was very fascinating learning about these different tool uses. It was a big shock to me to find that, like us, chimpanzees have a brutal, aggressive side, even a kind of primitive war. The adult males will patrol the boundaries of their territory. It turns out they're very territorial. And if they see an individual of a neighboring social group, that individual is likely to be hunted down, attacked, subjected to a severe gang attack, and is most likely to die as a result of wounds inflicted. Only the adolescent females, before they've given birth, will be actually encouraged to join a neighboring community, and this is how you get genetic mix from one group to another. Like us, they also have a compassionate and loving and altruistic side to their nature. If a mother dies and she leaves an infant that's under 3 years old, that child will die because they're relying on their mother's milk. It's a very long childhood. But if the child is more than three and has an older brother or sister, that sibling is likely to adopt the child. And by the way, young males make wonderful caregivers. This particular infant, little Mel, when his mother died, he was 3 and a half. He had no older brother or sister. We didn't think he'd survive. To our amazement, a young adolescent male, 12-year-old spindle, adopted him, carried him from place to place, shared his food when Mel begged, drew him into his night nest so that the two slept curled up together, and took on the role of a mother in supporting little Mel if he got into social difficulties. So Spindle would even run in to move Mel if he got too close to the big males when they were competing for social dominance. When they have these dramatic displays and they hurtle across the ground, stamping with their feet, slapping with their hands, dragging branches, hurling rocks. If an infant gets in the way, it seems they don't really notice because they may pick up that infant and throw it as though it's a rock. And the mother's job is to make sure her infant gets out of the way. And Spindle took on that job, even though he often got beaten up by the adult males for getting too close himself. So without any doubt, Spindle saved Mel's life. And I could tell many stories like that, but we don't have time for them tonight. It's pretty clear how like us chimpanzees are, and we now know today how like us also they are biologically, so that the DNA of humans and chimpanzees differs by only just over 1%. That means 98.6% of the DNA, our DNA and chimpanzee DNA, is almost identical. Also, the similarity in the composition of the blood and the immune system, which is why chimpanzees have been used in medical research to test vaccines or cures for diseases which other animals, less like us, cannot be infected with. Scientists who refuse to admit the equally striking similarities in emotion and in intellect and in personality. So the brain of chimpanzee and human is almost identical in anatomy, although ours is bigger. When I'd been in the field 1.5 years, Lewis Leakey sent me a letter, and he told me I would have to get a degree to stand on my own feet, to get my own money, when he was no longer there to do so. He said, "We don't have time for you to get a BA." He'd found me a place in Cambridge University to do a PhD in ethology. I didn't even know what ethology was. Remember, I hadn't been to college at all. And of course, I eventually found out it simply meant studying animal behavior. So I got to Cambridge, and I was very nervous. And imagine how I felt when some of the professors, of whom I was greatly in awe, told me that I'd done my whole study wrong. I shouldn't have given the chimpanzees names. That wasn't scientific. They should have had numbers. And I certainly couldn't talk about them having personalities. I couldn't talk about them having minds capable of thinking. And I absolutely couldn't talk about them having emotions like happiness, sadness, fear, despair, because those were unique to us. Fortunately, when I was a child, I had a wonderful teacher. A teacher who taught me that for all their scientific knowledge, those professors were wrong. And that teacher was my dog, Rusty. You cannot share your life in a meaningful way with a dog, a cat, a pig, a horse, a bird, I don't care, and not know the professors were wrong. So I was able to have the courage of my conviction. And my main supervisor, my thesis advisor, came to Gombe, and he was won over. He told me he learned more in the 2 weeks he was there than in all his previous scientific life before. So he helped me to write about what I believed in such a way that I couldn't be torn apart by other skeptical scientists. And I got my PhD. And I went back to Gombe. What an idyllic life. I'd built up a research station. I had students from around the globe. I had a Hungarian student, Géza Teleki, who was a leading light, and I believe his widow is here somewhere in the audience, Heather. And PhD students going to Cambridge, going to Stanford University. I had time in the field to collect data. I loved analyzing the data. I was able to do some writing of popular books. I had a child along the way. I married the filmmaker who'd been sent by the Geographic, Hugo van Lawick. I did some teaching at Stanford University. And it was a life even more idyllic than I could have imagined when I was a child. And yet, now, I'm traveling 300 days a year around the world. Why? Why did I leave this wonderful life? It was 1986. There was a conference bringing together the different people studying chimpanzees, mostly in the wild. There were about 8 other research stations at that time, but also some captive conditions, some captive situations like non-invasive research in zoos and so forth. And we brought all these people together, and there was a session on conservation, and it was shocking. It was absolutely shocking, because all the scientists working in the field showed slides or film of forests being destroyed, of the big logging companies moving in. They showed chimpanzees being caught in wire snares set for other animals. There was the beginning of the bushmeat trade, that is the commercial hunting of wild animals for food, which is very different from the subsistence hunting that's been going on for hundreds of years. And it was very clear that chimpanzee numbers were dropping dramatically. We had a session on the situation in medical research labs. I can never forget that. Seeing our closest living relatives imprisoned in 5-foot by 5-foot cages, about 7 foot high. And they were there on their own, these very social beings. The only time two were together was for breeding, to produce more infants, to go through the same traumatic experience. And I knew that I had to try and do something. I went to that conference planning to carry on with my idyllic life. I left it as an activist. And so since October 86, I haven't been anywhere more than 3 weeks consecutively, and that's only for about twice in a year. I don't know what I thought I could do, but I just knew I had to do something. And I got a little grant, and I went to Africa, and I visited as many of the range countries as I could. And I was learning more and more about the problems faced by the chimpanzees. But I was also learning more about the problems faced by so many of the African people living in poverty around the chimpanzee habitats, learning about their lack of health facilities, learning about the lack of educational facilities, learning about the ethnic violence. It was the late 80s that I flew in a small plane over the very tiny Gombe National Park, which is on the eastern shore of Lake Tanganyika. That's the long, thin lake that goes south to north up Africa. And when I arrived in 1960, there was a belt of forest. We called it the Equatorial Forest Belt. And it went along the eastern shore of Lake Tanganyika, curled round through Burundi and Uganda, and then into the Congo Basin. When I flew over Gombe in the late 80s, I looked down on a little island of forest surrounded by completely bare hills. It was obvious there were more people living there than the land could support, too poor to buy food from elsewhere, the people struggling to survive. And that's when I realized, unless we help the people to improve their lives, there's no way we can even try to save the chimpanzees. And so the Jane Goodall Institute, with a very small grant from the European Union, began a program called Take Care, or TACARI. And when we started this program, we didn't deliver aid in the way that was so typical of well-meaning, but not really a good way of doing things. Very often, well-meaning people will go into a poor village and say, well, you're not doing very well, are you? We're going to help you. This is what we're going to do. We chose a team of local Tanzanians. They didn't even have PhDs, but they'd worked for non-for-profit organizations in health, in education, agriculture, forestry. They went into 12 villages around Gombe and asked the people what they thought we could do to make their lives better. And that's where we started, with agriculture, with health, and with education, working with Tanzanian authorities for the health and the education, and gradually got the people's trust. And gradually they began to understand that as they destroyed the surrounding, the area surrounding their villages, so their own lives were getting more and more difficult. I think one of the most important aspects of the program which we introduced was microcredit opportunities for groups of women so that they could select their own environmentally sustainable projects. And if they paid back the money, then they could take out a larger loan if they so wished.
One of our most successful programs was scholarships to keep as many girls in school as we could after puberty. And it's been shown all around the world that as women are empowered, that as women's education improves, family size tends to drop. And that was one of the big problems as to why the area around Gombe had been so destroyed. Anyhow, we also introduced family planning information, which was very well received.
We made this TACARI program successful, and so successful that the trees have begun to come back. I'll return to that later. And we were able to introduce the same sort of program. You remember my mother told me, never give up. We're introducing this program to improve the lives of the people around chimpanzee habitat in Uganda, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, in Congo Brazzaville, and in Senegal. So we're doing what we can to improve the lives of the people so that they will then turn around and help us to conserve the chimpanzees, which is really important considering the way that chimpanzee numbers are still dropping. There were between 1 and 2 million chimpanzees when I began in 1960, and today there are 250,000 maximum spread over 21 different countries, many in small isolated groups that don't have much chance of long-term survival. So it's a pretty grim situation. However, the Jane Goodall Institute is working very hard on the ground, and we've also been working to improve conditions in captive situations like medical research. Last year in America, the National Institutes of Health agreed that all nearly 400 chimpanzees should be released from medical research programs and retired into sanctuaries. Well, while I was traveling around in Africa, learning about the plight of chimpanzees and learning about the plight of the people, I was realizing that many of the problems of the African people, not all of them, many of them, could be traced back to the old days of colonialism, where wealthy people went into Africa, took out the natural resources, including slaves, and left the people poorer. And I realized that, to some extent, many of the big multinational corporations are doing exactly the same today. So that it was important to start talking about these things in the rest of the world. And I began in Europe and North America and have gradually moved into other parts of the world. And in doing so, learning more and more about the problems that we are inflicting on the planet. I talked about chimpanzee-human similarities, but there is a big difference, isn't there? When you think, okay, chimpanzees are very intelligent, they can do things that we never dreamed that they could do before. They can learn more than 500 signs, as used by deaf people, American Sign Language, use them in the right context. They can learn to use the touchpad, solve quite difficult problems on computers. But that doesn't compare with the kind of technology that we have developed, with the kind of literature, with the architecture. There's no comparison. And so what is the main difference, I think? The explosive development of our human intelligence, our human intellect. So it doesn't make sense, does it, that the most intellectual creature to ever walk on planet Earth is destroying its only home. It seems that we've lost wisdom. We're making major decisions, not with any thought of how this will affect future generations, but simply, how will it affect me now, or the next shareholders meeting, or the next election campaign? Those are the criteria we're using. There seems to be a disconnect between the head and the heart. And I truly believe that only when head and heart work in harmony can we achieve our true human potential. As I'm traveling around and learning more about all that we're doing to harm this poor planet, learning about the deforestation, the acidification of the ocean, so that forests and oceans are the two main absorbers of carbon dioxide, which is the worst of the, or the most plentiful, of the so-called greenhouse gases leading to climate change, to global warming. And they're trapping the heat of the sun on the Earth's surface. So the burning, reckless burning of fossil fuel is also releasing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. And something which people either don't know or don't want to know is the terrible effect that is being apparent around the world as more and more people get wealthier and eat more and more meat. And let's forget the terrible cruelty to the animals in the factory farms. Let's just think that to grow the grain to feed these billions of animals, forests are cut down, and huge amounts of fossil fuel are used to transport the grain from where it's grown to the factory farms, then to transport the animals to the killing abattoirs, and then to transport the meat from there to the table. And in addition to that, this huge amount of carbon dioxide that's released, in addition to that, when you put food in one end of an animal, including ourselves, by the way, gas comes out the other end, and that's methane. And that is an even more virulent greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. So that is leading to an increase in the greenhouse gases. Fresh water supplies all around the globe are shrinking. And I think if you all know some of the other ways that we're harming this poor old planet. If everybody on this planet attained the same level of life, same lifestyle as we have in this room, we apparently would need 4, or some people say 5, new planets to provide the natural resources. Isn't it crazy that we're told by the economists that we have to have unlimited economic growth? How can we have unlimited economic growth on a planet with finite natural resources? And it seems to me there are 3 major, seemingly insoluble problems that we somehow have to solve. One is crippling poverty, because you destroy the environment because you have to, either to grow crops to feed your family, to get charcoal, to get some money to feed your family, or if you're living in an urban area, to buy the cheapest foods, no matter how they were made, how much environmental destruction, how far they've had to travel, wasting fossil fuels. So crippling poverty is one of the problems that we have to solve, and there are ways of doing that, and we're proving that that's so. But then there's the unsustainable lifestyle of so many of the people, so many of the other people. And that's not even considering the excesses of the super rich. That's just all of us. And how many of us in this room could raise our hand and say, I don't have more than I need? We all have more than we need. I have more than I need. I know that. I try to think about it. I try to do my best, but I know I have far more than I need. But how do you change a whole culture? That's not easy. But somehow we have to raise the standard of living of the poor and somehow make it more equitable with the standard of living of everybody else. And then we have human population growth. These 3 things now leading to climate change seem to be very, very hard to solve. Not surprising, as I'm traveling around the world, I'm meeting young people who seem to have lost hope. I'm talking about high school, university students. And some of them were depressed, some of them were angry, even violent. Most of them just apathetic, not seeming to care. And when I began talking to them, they all said more or less the same. We feel like this because you're compromising our future, and there's nothing we can do about it. Are we compromising the future of our young people? Yes, we are. All those babies that we just saw being born, what is their future going to be like if we can't address some of these problems? And is it too late to do something about it? I don't think so. I think we have a window of time. It may be wishful thinking. I know we can solve the problems. Whether or not we have time, I don't know. But this is why I started our youth program, Roots and Shoots, which is
probably one of the main programs of the Jane Goodall Institute, along with saving forests and chimpanzees in Africa. Roots and Shoots began with 12 high school students in Tanzania 25 years ago. It's now in about 100 countries with about 100,000 active groups, and a group can be a whole school. And we have members in kindergarten, members in university, where it's very strong, and everything in between. Roots and Shoots is growing in Hungary. And this program has as its main message, every one of us makes a difference every day. We cannot live through a day without making some kind of impact, and we have a choice as to what kind of impact we will make. We can think about the consequences of the small choices we make, what we buy, what we eat, what we wear, where was it made, how far has it come, did it involve harm to the environment, cruelty to animals, cruelty to people. These small choices seem unimportant when we make them, but imagine if they're made by millions and then billions of people, we start moving to a better, fairer world. And so every group of Roots and Shoots chooses for itself, depending on the age of the group, the country, the culture, the religion, three different kinds of project to make the world better. One to help people, one to help other animals, one to help the environment we all share, or one big project that encompasses all three of these different kinds of ways of improving things on planet Earth. And I'm going to show you the next, a very short piece of video. It was made about 6-7 years ago. We've come a long way since then, but it will give you some idea of the kind of projects that these young people are doing around the world. The dark green is where we have most Roots and Shoots.
Some people think it's far away. Some know it's with them every day. You are the reason we found out. So thank you, star. There are no winds that can blow it away on the air. When they try to blow it away, is when you know we will always be there. To some, it's the strength to be a part.
Hello.
To some, it's a feeling in the heart.
Oh, I think you're a bit near.
And when you're out there on your own, it's the way back home.
So that gives you some idea of the kind of projects that are being done. Roots and Shoots is my greatest reason for hope. And I'm going to end very quickly with my four other reasons for hope. One, this human brain, I know we can use it for bad things, but think of the good, wonderful, innovative technology that has been produced by our intellect. And if governments would get behind the use of solar energy, wind energy, Well, this is just the end of this. My reasons for hope, the fact that our human brain is capable of amazing technology, like microphones when they work, and the fact that we could be free of oil and gas if governments would support the technology of solar, wind, and so forth, instead of oil and gas corporations. The next reason I hope, the resilience of nature, places that we have absolutely destroyed can be brought back to life and given some kind of new green image. I'm talking rubbish now, sorry. Places that we've destroyed can once again, with a bit of effort and hard work and perhaps time, once again become green and support animal life as they used to. And animal species on the brink of extinction can be given another chance. I've been fortunate in going out into Hungarian nature just on this trip in these 2 days to see people working on restoring animals, birds, snakes that were becoming extinct. And I should mention that all around Gombe today, if you fly over that whole area, you will no longer see bare hills. The trees have come back. The chimpanzees have 3 times more forest now than they had 12 years ago. So we can restore the natural world with effort. The next reason for hope is the indomitable human spirit, the people who tackle seemingly impossible tasks and won't give in, people who have crippling disabilities and yet are out there inspiring others, people like Nelson Mandela and so forth, just the most amazing people. And they're all around us in everyday life, people who won't give up, who inspire others. And finally, social media, which I just discovered when I was part of the climate march in New York, when the organizers expected 80,000 people, there were nearly 400,000 people. Everybody was Twittering and tweeting and Facebooking and messaging and using their cell phones to tell their friends to come, that it was fun, that the weather was great, a whole lot of film stars. And that was happening in major cities around the world. So it was the biggest gathering of people around a single issue in the history of mankind. And that's how we can use social media, so that people struggling, feeling alone, can need no longer feel alone. They can reach out and realize that there are hundreds and thousands and maybe millions of other people who feel just as passionate as they do, and they will be supported and can work harder to make this a better world. And my last word, don't forget, every single one of us in this room makes a difference every single day, and we have a choice as to what kind of difference we'll make. So I apologize for the technology, but I hope that you've managed to get most of the message. I hope so. Thank you. Okay, I know we're going to have a discussion, but before that, I want to say I could do nothing alone. We have 31 Jane Goodall Institutes around the world, one of which is here in Hungary. And the reason that what's happening in Hungary is working is because of these people. It's because of the chairman of our board, Enika, who's standing here with me now. And I would like the other board members to come up. To just start coming, don't wait till I call your name. But it's Shushi and Andresh and Gabor. Could you please come up here? And then we have our executive director, Bogi, and we have our Roots and Shoots coordinator, Sylvia, and we have an amazing volunteer team. And I actually would, like Ben Zamate and to come up, because he's the one who showed me the birds this morning and is an absolute icon in Hungary for restoring the environment and protecting endangered species. I don't know if Belny is here. Belny, who does restoration of snakes. If you're here, come up. And then there's the wonderful volunteers, so many volunteers. Could you come up? Because I want you all to see what JGI Hungary is doing and can do. And these are the people making it happen. So let's have the volunteers. Come on.
This is a really exciting moment for me.
The Jane Goodall Institute's Chimpunga Chimpanzee Rehabilitation Center in the Republic of Congo has for years been caring for infants whose mothers were killed, mostly for the illegal bushmeat trade. Many of them are now fully grown. Recently, we acquired three large forested islands on the beautiful Quiloo River, where we can release many of the chimpanzees from our overcrowded center.
In here is Wunda, and she nearly died, but thanks to Rebecca, she came back from the dead. And here she is about to come out into this paradise. She's the 15th chimpanzee to get her freedom here. And we hope ultimately to have about 60 on the island.
Today is the first time I've met Wunda. I talked to her on the boat, trying to reassure her. She must have wondered what was happening. None of us could predict exactly what she would do once the cage door opened. It was a very, very touching moment. One of the most amazing things that's ever happened to me. The warmth of her embrace is something I shall never forget. For Wunda and all the other chimpanzees we're working to bring here, Chinzula Island will provide a wonderful forest home where they will be cared for and safe.
Let me just end up with the end of this story, which takes us back to the beginning of this evening. Our chimpanzees in Chimpunga are all on birth control because, I say, we have 165 still infants coming in from the bushmeat trade and the live animal trade, and we cannot afford to have more babies. We have no space. The islands are not expandable. They're a limited space, and they have implants. Well, over all these years, one implant went wrong. Just one. And that implant went wrong last year, and the mother whose implant went wrong was Wunda. Everybody was so happy that Wunda was the one to have a little baby. She turned out to be an amazing mother. The baby is called Hope, and the baby is now 4 months old, and I got a picture of the baby just yesterday. And you know, actually, one baby every 5 years for a community is probably a really good thing. I've always said that. It brings the community together. There is great love of baby chimpanzees in both the males and the females. So hopefully, little Hope will help the community to settle down. And Wunda, by the way, although she's a female, has become the dominant of the 60 individuals on the island where she now is, and she's even managed so far to dominate the males. That won't last for too long. So anyway, so we end up with the birth, and we end up, as I say, where we began this evening, and we end up with a message of hope. So thank you all.